course.
Thank you so much.
It was Megan's group that established Sandra.
Who's my friend?
Megan.
Oh.
It'd be better if we all ate at Sandra, so we'd all have black in our teeth.
Happy birthday.
Okay, so today's class, we are finishing up what? Where?
Who wrote the six artists of the High Renaissance of Italy?
Michelangelo, Raphael, Raphael.
Not Jonathan.
Oh, wait, you're right. I was thinking Teenage Mutant.
That screwed me up too.
Bramante.
And Raphael.
Titian.
Da Vinci.
Well, the circle of the tree, I cannot throw.
Giacchioni.
Giacchioni. That's only five. This is Michelangelo, Da Vinci, Bramante.
Raphael.
Giacchioni, Titian. And then where did we stop? So this fresco behind the altar is, what's it called? Last Judgment. And it depicts the pillars of heaven being taken down, the wheel that spins the universe being, the gear being broken. And then in the center is God the Father. And we just started looking at a few details. So, if you were describing his design style, we would say that he's really trying to put the body in every position possible, and that he is more into ideals than any other person of the High Renaissance as far as body types, this sense of ideal perfection. Great musculature. And I think it's very, very hard, I know it's hard for my students, to give up parts of the body in order to put it in a position. Because you want to say everything. But, so he's using foreshortening, but he's not just doing the lines in a grid, he's doing a human form. So he's working on the back side of the altar between 1509 and 1510. The central portion is the figure of Christ, and he's either saying, let it all begin, or it's all over now. And huddled in his arm is the figure of his mother, Mary. Mary's always associated with him. then on the left of God the Father, and everybody is focusing on the Christ figure, sorry. Let's see. He's the scholar that was questioning the faith of the church. So questioning, and then on the right side is the figure of Michelangelo, I don't think the book calls it that, actually holding his own skin. He was just never comfortable with doing this painting. Very expressive, a lot of hand gestures. That this figure over here is who? On the right?
Moses?
No? Where does he have his hand?
Oh, the one that's standing up.
Yeah, a huge key. Because he is.
St. Peter?
Yeah. The keys to the kingdom. And then here you have this figure that is, seems to me to be both male and female. Definitely masculine muscles. And this is all done in the fresco technique. Another depiction of a female that is questionable. What? I think the church forbid him from using female models, so I guess he could be excused. He could have done this on his own time. Definitely an understanding of the human body. The criticism is that they're over muscular, so that they're not like individual body types. They're all sort of this ideal perfection of muscles, so like a wrestling match.
Male muscles,
yeah. But quite a variety of emotions being portrayed. They're being lowered to hell or raised up. I think they're supposed to be being raised up from limbo. So limbo is the place where if you're not bad enough to go to hell and you're not good enough to go to heaven, you're in limbo, the place in between. And I believe they're being yanked up from there. So the dead shall rise up on this judgment day. So we have a skeletal face. Such a great variety. It shows us it was very, very intelligent. And really considering the scale and the variety, it's a wonder that he completed it.
interesting. So those long forms, they're sort of like announcement forms for the papacy, and they would have had a banner on them. A devil trying to beat people down. That subtle reference to the Middle East. The Middle East here is a darker, I guess, have horns.
There's no racism in Slotville.
The what?
There's no racism in Slotville.
Yeah, no. But it's also subtle. It's so convincing that they aren't going to accept these other people because it's so subliminal that it's ingrained. These are the bad people. And we're the good people. Always question what you look at. So again, this is the high altar of the Sistine Chapel. Those doors are 8 to 10 feet in height that you see by the sides of the chapel. So this is, it's a huge undertaking for a single person. Always great negative. Okay, and then his real desire was to be so much a sculptor, but that's not what he was necessarily paid for. This one, when you have the adult Christ deceased in the arms of his mother, and put him back this way.
It's backwards.
Yeah. Okay. Pietà, yep. And what's the pietà? Okay, it means sorrow in Italian. Again, the greatest horror is for the child to die before the parents, and that is universal for us.
So is this her face in this still considered
No, now she's just classical ideals in here. No, he doesn't use a classical phase where the mouth is not open. And this is, remember, it's done by hand without any power tools. And really, he is an admirer of Praxiteles. Does that mean to you? That's Phidias. Sensuous texture. So contrast in textures. You have the fabric of the clothing, the skin of Christ, and this has a universal appeal, both emotionally as the mother surviving the child, but also, Mary stands up. She is an Amazon compared to her son. And that is intentional because it is also Mother Earth, the depth of the seasons. That type of universality is what Leo was hoping for. What is, again, the substructure when you designed this work? What is this overall shape? The triangle. So as being the most universal, the most stable. About 20 years ago, someone attacked this with a hammer.
sculpture, if not, I'm not really into classical, but I would say it's one of the most beautiful things anyone could ever look at. And they attacked it, a group of modern artists attacked it, because they thought if they could get rid of that, theoretically, then people would start looking at new art, which is really a shame. But so now the way you have to look at this, it must have been modern art.
We have a problem with people not looking at modern art, only looking at ancient art. I feel like it's the other way around.
So they, you have to get on a conveyor belt, and it takes you past this statue. You can't really even look at it for a long time. It is exquisite and beautiful. So in Michelangelo, we see this return to classicism, this interest in ideal beauty. And then his most well-known was actually the civic symbol that was outside of the Palazzo Vecchio, the town hall of the city of Florence, which is
so
David.
This one's like, these ones are before he got, these ones are before he got way too close.
This is 1501, and David himself is 18 feet in height, and it has the action and repose. He looks like he could work. He was only 26 years old when he completed this. He was truly interested in the work of Donatello. We see, not only does he have a contrapposto stance, but there is sort of a tweak to his knee going inward on his left leg. It's so relaxed and loose. So he has the slingshot over his shoulder, the rock in his hand, so certain of himself. And I haven't read your papers yet. I read my notes before I corrected the paper, but who corrected it? I hope that you would see this as the ideal, a sense of perfection in the nude. And then 18 feet makes it well over life size, so it's heroic or monumental in scale. Well over life size, you know, not just 9 feet, this is 18 feet tall. So
but does that include the face that it's on, or that's just the statue?
That is just the statue.
Okay.
I have a better, I meant to get the handout, Megan will remind me. I have a handout of, they're in the lift trying to wash him, and that gives you a sense of scale.
So this was the one that was outside the Palazzo Vecchio?
Mm-hmm. And it was actually designed for the cathedral, but then it was never put there.
So what you said he was interested in Donatello, is that just because Donatello was the one that brought back the life-size movie?
Well, I hope in your comparison, there's a languid quality in this work that is really reflective of Donatello's. Donatello's work is towards the feminine more. And he adopted that early on, but then as Megan said, everyone suddenly got buff. This slide is distorted. Okay, this, he had been called off the Sistine Chapel to work for the popes and to produce a tomb for Julius II, in 1513. And this is, I think that you have the whole scheme in your book. This is on the left, and it's the personification of night. What's personification? Right. So it's giving something that isn't human, representation. So an allegory. So. And I'm not certain about the mask on the right or the bird under the woman. But there again, we take off her breast, it's very new. To my knowledge, it doesn't seem to be female.
Look, you only study male bodies and put boobs on it. That's what we did.
And then in your text, the guy in the slave. It's occasionally called the rebellious slave. Okay. This is also from the complex of the term, the tomb sculptures. This one, rebellious slave. And what's the height in your book? Where does it say the awakening captive? 1525. What's the height?
1811.
Right, so this is taller than the doorway, so it's an over life size figure. And it was never completed. So it's sort of instructive in being released from the stone. Moses seated at 7 feet 8.5 inches, and so a seated figure averages 4 feet. So this is again twice life size. On the very last one I put in is, I think in this edition of the book, but it is the sculpture he was making for his own tomb. And it's from 1555 to 1564. It has two names. It's called the Milan Pietà, and also the Pietà Rondinini, R-O-N-D-A-N-I-N-I, for the person who owns it. 77 and 8 inch in height. And it really, what's the difference with this figure and the other figures of Michelangelo? It's not muscular, it's more emotional, expressive, than muscular. And it's interesting because the Christ figure is sagging down, his mother is in sorrow, and it's more evidence of emotion than ideal perfection of the body type.
Was it terribly fun?
Yes, because they all sort of give an emotion of something to come.
So like even the ones, is that in all of his,
Yeah, I think so, because the body type is sort of telling you that they're about to do something. And remember that the high Renaissance artists anticipate styles that come later. And this elongated form that is twisting and turning becomes emphasized in the late Renaissance by another group of artists. So terribly, it's sort of the agony of the inner soul. Interesting that he's making it for his own tomb. Okay, then we've done Da Vinci, Bramante, Michelangelo, and then the central painter of the High Renaissance is Raphael. 1483-1520. And unlike the other artists before him, he did not do architectural schemes, and he did not do sculpture of any sort. His work is more lyrical, and he said he aimed to paint as Da Vinci. What's that mean? But he wanted to design like Michelangelo, so a good sense of negative shape. To that, we add a great deal of monumentality. So he first made his living doing these, I would call rather pleasant religious works of the Virgin and the Christ Child. This is the Madonna in the Meadow from 1505. Is this one or similar one?
Similar.
I have a few. Atmospheric perspective, the ability to do the human form in interaction, the classical pyramid as the presentation, 1505. He also gives us a sense of linear perspective. So it is very pleasing to look at. It doesn't have the disturbance of Michelangelo's, even the Last Judgment, there is a sort of a torment going on. So by comparison to Raphael, it is terrible either.
What was that one called?
The Madonna in the Meadow. I think you're not responsible for this one.
That's the one in our book.
Is it? It's a horrible story. Which one is this one?
Lafell.
Jeunet. Yes, it must be owned by the French. It means.
Does it mean beautiful art?
It does. Atmospheric perspective, suggested linear perspective, and believable children. Rounded volume to the figures, but he is truly presenting different physical types, not the ideal of Michelangelo. This one is in a tondo, T-O-N-D-O, which is this round circular format. And you must stipulated living to the Virgin Chapel. And then in the Sistine Chapel, in the room of signatures, which is next to the Vatican, next to the Sistine Chapel, he was commissioned to make four murals that would describe the four domains of learning. So he did one for theology, one for philosophy, one for law, and one for the arts. And this is for philosophy, and it's called the School of Athens from 1510. So it's the full size of the room. To the corner there is the doorway. So it's the top of the doorway right there. And then there is a very real arch that is part of the architecture of the room. And Raphael has mimicked the arch in barrel vaults, showing linear perspective, and then of course atmospheric perspective, because they get lighter as they go back. And in this School of Athens, there are clusters of philosophers. And in the center is Aristotle. Da Vinci, Da Vinci's Last Supper, he has made an architectural setting to set apart the people in the painting. So Aristotle and Plato, Plato being in the blue, Aristotle on the left. Say that, like, about Aristotle, he said everyone needs to do nothing for 1 hour a day. Just think.
That's Aristotle?
Yeah.
But that was Einstein.
Einstein took it from him.
Probably.
Yeah. Aristotle has a lot of books that are really quotable. Okay, so if we're thinking about him in relating him to Donatello, we see that there is a softness to the human form. There's a lyrical quality that brings us from one figure to the next figure. It's organized by legs, arms, and heads. And then again, wanting it to be life size so that we could feel that we could be there. And definitely a very believable architectural scheme. What is, so, Raphael didn't do sculpture, he didn't do architecture, but he had a tremendous vocabulary of content in his painting. So he did religious works, he did his huge frescoes. That's a poor slide, I thought, over-brightened. And then a bad slide, you have a better version in your book. This is a very large scale, secular fresco at the Villa Farnesina, which is the Pope's private palace. So in it we have Galatea, who was a nymph, pursued by Polyphemus, who's the guy trying to steal the woman on the left. She's riding the seashell. And again, this is 9 feet 8 inches by 7 feet 4 inches. The High Renaissance anticipates the styles of the future.
And so this is secular?
Yes.
And what was the guy's name?
Raphael painted it.
No, I mean...
Of Polyphemus.
P-O-L-Y-P-H-E-M-U-S.
And Gladia is the central figure. Gladia's figure is posed, and everything swirls in a circle around her. And that is an innovation in design. And so the spiral of Michelangelo, this circular motion established by Raphael, is taken into the Baroque style after the late Renaissance. Were the fat angels the ladies called?
Coutas?
Coutas. In that commission piece for Pope Leo X and his nephews, who were also cardinals, Giovanni Gianucci and Luigi de Rossi, were local responsible for their names. So Pope Leo X and his nephews. This is a true portrait. We're moving about.
That's
true. That is what they look like, but it is a psychological portrait. So would you like him to decide your fate? No. Does he look kind? No. Does he look benevolent? No. Does he look wealthy? Yes. So he has very rich satin on the top, and he's got this brocade sleeves. He holds a little magnifying glass. And where is the triangle in this image? Central figure is a triangle, but there's also a V-shaped triangle going from the Pope to his nephews. It's a flattened triangle. So he's interpreting the Bible. What do you think about his nephews?
Well, like,
catering
to him.
Well, where are they looking? Yeah, two different directions. So they're truly shifty. They're shifting their eye point. And so that's a statement about their character.
What are the... Are you talking about the triangles?
There's two triangles. There's the traditional one. Yeah. That you pointed
like
out.
Like the negative space that they hold in place.
Well, going like this from the heads to heads creates a V shape. And then there is a pillar behind them, but not on the side. So, this is certainly a finesse of Pope textures, right? Very elegant presentation of satin and brocade and velvet of the tablecloth, contrast in skin and chair. This is way beyond anything we have seen. They're also full-volumed figures. They're not flat like done in the north, so we know they're Italian. Facial detail, not flattering at all. they look like a scary bunch. What?
Was this for John Harrison or no?
Yes, definitely.
So he was, did you say he kind of took like the northern influences and the Italian influences and put them both to a high point?
Right, well, he's basing it on Da Vinci. Da Vinci had a love of psychology. And certainly this is a psychological portrait. I think we could say they're not nice people.
Yeah. Just thinking like design wise, I thought. Seems like he took all the designs that the Northerners were doing and the Italians and kind of put them all together.
Well, it's really interesting that none of them are relating to each other in the same lodge. Okay, then we go to further north, to the Venetian area, to the work of Giorgione, 1478 to 1510. Truly right next to the north. So we have a very large, expansive view of landscape. We have the linear perspective of the canal. And then we have the enigma. So the puzzle here is that the title of the painting is what? From 1505. It's small scale, like the Northerners. It's only 31 by 28 inches. It doesn't have a flat background. It has very turbulent sky. And so the viewer looks at this and tries to decide what the painting is about. We have a woman nursing a child, which is very kind of like Madonna and Child, but what's the big difference? Why automatically would this not be the Madonna and Child? Yeah, she's new in color, right? And then we have this well-dressed gentleman that holds a staff in his hand, so he might be a shepherd. However, he's way too well-dressed, and he becomes a voyeur to the woman seated with the child. So he is kind of bringing disparate objects together and introducing it as a thought-provoking painting. And then this is Venice. These are recognizable canal with things that one would have seen in Venice at that time period. So remember this, there's no camera in the way. We have a camera, so they are introducing reality. This is real because it is the city of Venice, a landscape. But then you have a nobleman with a working class staff, and then a nude female taking care of her child. It's also considered poetic. So what's happening? When are you poetic?
When you kind of describe something you're not getting
at. And use allegory, right? So one thing representing another thing. And again, open to interpretation. It's a thought rather than a clear statement. And the beginning of an introduction of sudden lights and darks, rather than a total use of chiaroscuro. There is some chiaroscuro on the figure, but her whole figure stands out from the landscape. As a painter, I would say, the way it was made was, he went out and he painted in the landscape. Then he came back in and was looking at a woman in the studio. and then someone else posed a third time because it doesn't quite mesh together. This one is in your text in a better view or coloring. This is a type of art work that is given the French name Fête Champêtre, F-E-T-E, Champêtre, C-H-A-M-P-E-T-R-E. What's a fête? We have a word that comes from fête.
Not too French.
No, but probably festival. Okay, so fête means party, and basically it's a party outside. But this is an odd party outside. It's 42 by 54 inches. And again, it creates an enigma of interrupted action called crystallized action. So in this puzzle, we have two gentlemen, like the voyeur, well-dressed, talking among themselves, and then we have two nudes who are probably meant to be muses, but that's a guess on my part. One who is getting water from a well, and the other who is about to play her musical instrument in a known setting that the person looking at this painting can say, oh, that's South Hill over there. And then, so it's an incongruous collection of people. And Fête Champêtre is the same as pastoral concert, 1909, but the art historical term is Fête Champêtre. So Giorgione and Titian were of the same age. I think Giorgione is slightly younger. And they painted together at times.
So Giorgione, all of his were in Venice?
But Titian was also from Venice, but he traveled more. So, this is attributed to both Titian and Giorgione. However, to me, it looks more like Titian's. So now we have a true interrupted or crystallized action. We have, again, clothed people and nude people and an unexplained party going on. What's the center of attention? Well, there's that, but it's really up here with the jug of wine. This is a bacchanal, that is, Bacchus is the bacchanal wine. And I think that is the title, 1518, B-A-C-C-H-A-N-A-L, 5B-5-6. Supposedly inspired by a classical story. Any excuse that there exists.
The bucket just is it Titian?
What?
In the bucket just says Titian.
Titian. I definitely think he's the majority painter,
yeah,
but it's been attributed to both of them.
Here it doesn't even attribute it to the gentleman.
So you have an interrupted action, sudden lights and darks. Even though there is still chiaroscuro, and this description of a known landscape and an enigma of presentation. Titian, the book says, he established the right of an artist to depict an imaginary world, but I would say in Christian doctrine, they were portraying something that was unseen, right? And making it concrete. And so that really is the predecessor to that thought. And Giorgione teachings are more in the manner of Bellini and Mantegna.
Bellini was
Saint Francis, yeah.
Okay.
It's called Saint Francis. Okay, this one is in your text.
Why are they more like them?
The background being Octavius in that particular work, but in Bellini's other work, introducing little puzzles to contemplate. Mantegna and Bellini were teachers, and they were related.
Oh.
And they were the teachers of Giorgione and Titian. This is the Pizarro family Madonna from 1526. It's 16 feet in height, so 6 feet taller than the ceiling. And of course, we would be standing here, and the first central figure would be seated. And why does the book mention this particular fresco? So again, we have real architecture and then painted architecture. What does the book call this example of? What's happening? You do a really good job with the title. So sacra conversazione. Conversazione is just conversation, sacred, holy conversation. They are all related to each other. We have the donors. We have the figure in the center with the testament. We have the Madonna and child further up. We have the angels in the heaven. We have the monks that serve the donors. We have family relatives all on the right. You know, everyone is in on this conversation. And these are all life-size figures and stop action effect, crystallized action, sudden lights and darks. So this sacra conversazione, as the book describes it, it is a holy conversation. So these people are being presented to the viewer as participating in an exchange with saints. So it's bringing honor to their family. They are blessed. Did a portrait of a pope, which is entirely different from what Raphael did. This is Pope Leo III with his grandsons, 1546. And the first thing we look at is interrupted action, right? Crystallized action. Then we have sudden lights and darks. And then we have a portrait of three people with three different personalities.
Could you explain crystallized action again? So it applies to this, it's the interrupted action along with enigma?
No, it's just that it's stop action effect. Okay. So it's called crystallized action.
Okay,
and every period defines it in art slightly differently, because we had an interrupted action in the Hellenistic period.
So Oh, that's just how they define it, but interrupting.
Titian, in this painting, as in the next one I'm showing, introduces something that makes him really the first person to truly use oil paint as it should be. He uses both a glaze and an impasto. So the opaque white of the garment of the patriarch has thicker paint on it than some of the other areas. What's thick paint again?
Impasto.
Impasto. What's thin paint? Glaze. This gentleman depicted as the Pope looks much more pleasant than the last Pope, but he also, you know, seems very, very ancient. And then this is the one I'm holding you responsible for of Titian's. It is crystallized action. And it is a political statement. It uses very thick impasto paint. It's called Christ Crowned with Thorns. '1570. So a little bit earlier, the Roman Catholics had an edict that they responded to the Protestant Reformation. So what was the Protestant Reformation again? They broke away, but what was their doctrine?
They were trying to make the doctrine more regular,
right, more human. So it's called the doctrine of Christian humanism. And there was a counter-reformation to that beginning about 1550. And, well, no, the counter-reformation will be you have Christian humanism, and then you have a counter to that in which they try to make the saints more acceptable to the general public in the Roman Catholic Church. They were trying to do the same thing. Here, Titian is criticizing the Vatican. So this gentleman who is dressed in contemporary garb to Titian is one of the Vatican police. So the Vatican police were the people rounding up those that they thought were not true to the church. And here, they're leading a charge against Christ. So this is a very political statement. Now, it could be said, oh, maybe he's saving Christ.
Which one's the card?
The one in the hat. And his costume is contemporary to Titian, and it is one of the Vatican guard. They'll dress like that. And you can see the very thick paint. It's over life size. Sudden lights and darks. Crystallized action. And it's Titian making a political statement against the Inquisition. And this is done in 1570. 9 feet, 2 inches by 6 feet. Again, life-size figures, monumental in scale.
So would heroic scale only apply to statues?
It has to be absolutely monumental. And it's a term used for sculpture generally, or monument. So who were the artists of the High Renaissance? also know those six artists well, you know what they stand for. They are turning points in the history of art. So this is the culmination of the Renaissance, that is the rebirth of classicism. And the six artists of the High Renaissance propel us into a different way of viewing classicism, which will start next semester. So next class we'll start our review. We'll do 2 or 3 days of review. Definitely 2. I don't know, but we should do the test on Monday or Wednesday. We'll see. What's this?
Wednesday.
Okay.
Or Friday.
No, Friday. But they have digital on Friday. But you seem to have a handle on it. I know I'm Jewish, I'm just a teacher, but...
It depends on the section.
What?
It depends on the section. I don't have a handle on it.
Okay. We will be ready to start your review, having fun over the vocabulary. Before you get to class, decide on study times,